So this is the algorithm. We take a Markov process characterized by Q. We initialize the chain with a state I. So x0 is equal to I. We generate a candidate using Q. We denote it by J as before. And then we decide using a draw from 0, 1 if we keep the candidate or not by comparing it with alpha ij, which is defined as we have seen before. If we decide to keep it, j becomes the next state. If not, I is the next state. We stay at the same state. And then we increase t by 1 and we start again. So as you see, this is quite easy to implement, but there are some difficulties. Well, the first difficulty is numerical, so we'll have to deal with probabilities. Probabilities can be very low numbers, and when you multiply low numbers, it's even lower. So it's usually preferable to work in the log space. So instead of verifying if r is less than alpha ij, well, I verify if log of r is less than the log of alpha ij. And the log of alpha ij is the minimum of these two terms, okay? Now, because r is anyway between 0 and 1, well, the log of r will, of course, be negative. Therefore, we don't even need to check if it is greater than 0 or not. So the condition that we'll apply in practice is this one. Let's apply the Metropolis-Hastings first on our simple example with the machine. So here we have target numbers, which are the number of days out of 32 that we would like the machine to be, 28, 3, and 1. This corresponds, once normalized, to the stationary distributions that we have here. Well, the point here is that I've used b and not pi, but of course in this case, because we can enumerate, it doesn't make a big difference. And what I've done is to use a Markov process to visit the space where the probability to be in the next state is exactly the same for each state, and it's equal probability. We will call this a random walk. So for each state, I jump on the next state by drawing from a uniform distribution. 1, 4, 1, 4, 1, 4, 1, 4. I have applied the Metropolis-Hastings algorithm for 10,000 iterations. I have collected statistics after I have dropped the 1,000 first days. And this is what we obtain. We have the number of accepts for each of the states, the number of rejects, and the simulated value. And as you can see, the simulated values are close to the target values, to a reasonable degree of precision. So this illustrates the concept. So I use here a pure random walk to explore the space. I jump from here and there. And then I use the target probability to decide which one I accept and which one I reject. Let's now apply the algorithm in the context of Bayesian inference that I was talking about in the beginning. If you remember, in this context, we want to draw from the posterior distribution, which is the distribution of the beta given the data y. And thanks to Bayes' theorem, we know that this is proportional to, and this is the notation for proportional to, remember, the proportionality factor does not matter in the context of Metropolis-Hastings. So we can just ignore this integral here. So this is proportional to the product of the prior distribution and the likelihood. In this example, I assume that the prior distribution is normally distributed and that the likelihood is calculated from the product of a logit model for each observation. Good, so this is the context, and now I will need to apply my Metropolis-Hastings algorithm. Note that here we are in a continuous case. We have defined the algorithm in the discrete case, but as you will see, the concepts are exactly the same. For the Q transition probability, I will also use a random walk. So the current state is beta I, so this is the current values of the betas. And what I will do, I will draw a random vector xi I from a normal distribution, multivariate normal distribution. And I will follow this vector using a step length lambda. So basically, I draw xi I, and my new candidate, beta j, is equal to beta I plus lambda times psi I. Good, so this is purely random work. What is the transition probability? So the probability to go from I to J, which actually is the same as the probability to go from J to Y, is simply the probability to draw the step Xi I. And we can derive it from the two values of beta, right? So this is phi, which is the PDF of the normal distribution, evaluated at beta J minus beta I divided by lambda. And this is symmetric. So Qij is equal to Qji. Note that there is an abuse of language here. Of course, in this formulation, Qij is not a probability. It's actually the value of the PDF. But it's actually convenient to think about it as a probability for the modeling point of view. Good. So the next thing is to define the reject criterion for Metropolis-Hastings. Well, here, because the transition probability of my process is a symmetric matrix, the Qs cancel out here. And this is actually the Metropolis version of the algorithm. So originally, Metropolis derived this algorithm when this transition probability were symmetric. And then Hastings generalized it in the case when it's not symmetric. And I will show you an example afterwards. So this is the minimum between the ratio of the target distribution and 1. So here, what are the target distribution? Well, this is the posterior, which is the product between the prior and the likelihood. At the numerator, we have this for beta j, which is the candidate, and in the denominator, we have beta I, which is the current state. Again, we work in the log space in order to address the numerical issues that I was talking about. Let's apply it on the real dataset. So here we will look at a mode choice, a transportation mode choice, which has been actually derived in the context of an old project in Switzerland called Swiss Metro, which was at the time a precursor to Hyperloop somehow. There was this system which was designed. It was a revolutionary maglev underground train that was supposed to run at 500 kilometers per hour. And we have collected data to see if the travelers in Switzerland would be actually interested in taking this mode of transportation. So to do that, we exposed them to an exercise where they had to choose between taking the train, taking the Swiss Metro, and taking the car for a given trip by describing the three alternatives in terms of travel time, travel cost, and so on. So the variables that we will consider here is the travel time for each of the alternatives that we have collected, the travel cost, and we have also the information about the ownership of a so-called general abonnement, which is a yearly subscription for public transportation. So people who own such a subscription, they don't have to pay for a specific journey by public transportation. So as I introduced in the beginning, a choice model is based on utility function. So I write here utility function for each mode. So this is for train. I have an intercept. I have a coefficient for the travel time, a coefficient for travel cost. And here, if the person holds a general abonnement, the travel cost will be zero. For Swiss Metro, I have also the time, the cost. I have no intercept. And for the car, I have the intercept, time, and cost. So in total, I have four unknown parameters. Beta time, the coefficient for time, beta cost, the coefficient for cost, and the two intercepts, one for train, one for car. The intercepts for Swiss Metro has been normalized to zero. Okay, and based on these utility functions, I can plug them in a logit model, for example, to obtain the probability that each mode is chosen as a function of beta. And from this probability, I can calculate the likelihood, which is what I need for my algorithm. So the data have been collected in 1998. 750 respondents have been invited, and we have been answering to several exercises. So in total, we have a little less than 7,000 choice data. And I will show you the Python code of the algorithm, because as I said, this is relatively simple to code. So here I have a function that calculates the posterior as a function of the likelihood and the values of beta by basically multiplying the likelihood with the prior. But we will work in the log space, so this will calculate the log of the posterior. I use a prior distribution with mean 0, 0, 0 and the variance 100. So basically this is the log of the prior and this is the log of the likelihood which has been provided to the function. Now this is the algorithm. I start with beta equals 0, 0, 0. This is the first state. I calculate the log likelihood function based on the logit model, and I use a software called Bayesian to do that. And I use the previously defined function to calculate the log of the posterior for this beta. Then I will perform 100,000 iterations and I will stock the draws. The first thing I do is to draw from a multivariate normal to perform the random walk. This gives me the next candidate for beta. I calculate the log likelihood for the next candidate, and I calculate also the posterior for this next candidate. And now I apply the formula for the Metropolis-Hastings algorithm. So I calculate the alpha, which is here the difference of the log likelihood. And here I decide to keep it or not using a draw from a uniform distribution. So if it is accepted, I use the candidate as the next beta, and I insert beta in the set of draws. So this is extremely simple to implement. On this chart, I have on the x-axis the draws of the number of iterations of this Metropolis-Hastings algorithm, and on the y-axis the average, because this is what will give me the estimates of the values of the parameters. I have also including horizontal lines which correspond to the values of the parameters that I obtained from maximum likelihood estimation. And here I have used for my random walk a step lambda equals 0.1 to move along the generated random direction. This algorithm has an accept rate of 7% in this context. And as we see very quickly, it converges to the true distribution, or at least to the same one as for the maximum likelihood. So it works pretty well. Now I've made some experiments. One, I have increased the step lambda. So here lambda equals 1. So I make long jumps. Well, the problem here is that by doing so, I miss some important values of the beta. I'm somehow moving away from good values. And therefore, the algorithm, in order to be able to get the target distribution, will reject way more candidates. So here, my accept rate is very low, 0.02%. And as you can see from the picture, the algorithm takes a while to converge, and even after 100,000 iterations, it's not very precisely corresponding to the target distribution. I've also tried the opposite. So with very short steps, in this case, of course, the accept rate increases significantly. We have 78.2%, but it takes longer for the Markov chain to reach stationarity because we make very small steps. So, and we start from 0, 0. So it takes time to reach the true values of the parameters. And as you can see from this picture, it takes longer time to reach stationarity. So it shows that the way you design the first process, the Q process, is extremely important. Because depending on this design, the algorithm can be fast or very slow. So this is extremely important. Just for the sake of the illustration, I have here plotted the histograms of the draws that you obtain for each of the parameters. And I have compared them with the value, again, of the parameter obtained from the maximum likelihood estimation. This is represented by the vertical dashed line. So as you can see, we have, roughly speaking, a normal distribution around the true value. So this is for the intercept for car, the intercept for train, the beta time, so the coefficient for travel time, and the coefficient for travel cost.